maybe you can tell us how you got into comics. I know you've probably told the story a few times, including to us on previous occasions, but I think it's a really cool story.
Well, I can show you some artifacts that might help.
That's good too, yeah. An illustrated history of Matthew Brown.
There used to be an author who sold books on the streets of Toronto named Crad Kolodny. He was kind of a misanthrope, and he would hold up a sign saying something like, "Disgusting garbage that will rot your brain."
Yeah, he was always down near Sam the Record Man and places like that.
Yeah. So I told him at one point that I was an artist, and he got in touch with me and asked if I would do the cover for this, Junior Brain Tumors in Action. So I did. Chester Brown found this in a bookstore. I had long lost my copy, but this is 1990. So that was when I was 18, and this was when I was still in high school and trying to make some kind of inroads. When I got in touch with Mark Tessier in Montreal, like I told you, when I sent him a message, my artwork, I sent it to a bunch of places. Mark and his friend Stéphane Olivier and the people that he did comics with printed these chapters here. Used my artwork in the Mactan Tax Saga, which is a multi-chapter sort of anti-capitalist yarn about a dystopian world and the artist's role in it. So that again was while I was still in high school that he approved of that. And when I moved, when I first dated,
I realized the camera's a little bit off center.
Oh yeah.
This way, so there's more Mark. Sorry, you're kind of almost cut off, Mark. There
you want me to start over?
No. Keep going.
We'll just.
So you met Mark when you were in high school?
Well, yeah, because I was going to go to University of Montreal, but it was a coincidence. He was the only person when I sent out packages of my photocopy drawings that I was doing during classes in high school. He was the only person who responded positively. And as it happened, I was applying to Concordia University in Montreal for two programs. So I had to go there to show my portfolio to the art department and do an audition for the drama department, the theater department. So that was when Mark looked at my portfolio and said, "We have to make a comic of your stuff." And this is that first book, Fear Itself, number one, where
you
I remember...
You were like in Montreal for your Concordia interview.
Yeah. It was all
met
done...
Mark for the first time.
And... Yeah. It was all done... throwing together
on the
materials
fly,
from
kind
my
of winging
sketchbook.
It. You guys were winging it.
We were winging it. And this is all stuff I remember drawing, mostly sitting in my high school classes, you know, or at home. These were stories that Mark published. And as I moved to Montreal, I started to try to draw longer stories. This is Fear Itself number 3, where you can see there's a character caught up in the machinery of modern life. So I was trying to challenge myself not just to do spontaneous punk type hallucinatory things, but like characters and dialogue.
But you were a young, brooding intellectual Marxist, basically, at that time.
Pretty
and
much,
this
yeah.
This was your outlet, this was your
that's
your
right.
modem of expression.
It was, but I have to be honest, you know, I had a fork in the road there between, I was accepted to both. I could study fine art or theater. And I chose to do theater because I thought you need other people to do that. You need the resources of a space to perform in, lights, music, and all. And I would be less lonely because if there was one thing that drawing comics was, you're right, I needed that outlet. But it was okay in high school because I was surrounded by my friends all the time. But when I got to Montreal, I was living far away from the campus and the people. I chose theater, and I just drew less and less until...
I love this drawing of the bike. Oh my god, that is like just so, like the fluidity of your line and the like the composition there.
Yeah, the dynamism. He's breaking the frame.
That's right.
As if there was a frame, but he's breaking the frame. Yeah. It's baroque. It's coming right at you.
All of this was without penciling, I think. Back when I did these stories, I just drew it right away, drew it right in ink.
You kind of have, it has the feel of, like, you're in the flow.
Without pencil.
Right? Like, it's just
without
like...
Pencil. Purely spontaneously, you
I think
were
so.
Able to draw a bike with all its component parts without a pencil.
Well, and you've got foreshortening, which I, you know,
yeah.
After eight years of bigger and
very...
drawing, lessened,
foreshortened.
I have trouble with foreshortening.
It was
so.
5 years of sitting in high school drawing constantly.
From comics too, right? The comics are really good at the foreshortening.
At the foreshortening.
The hands coming out the fist.
I learned from reading
yeah.
the comics I like. And I took art classes. But, I mean, yeah, like you said, this was a form of expression, and it was my comfort zone, I guess you could say, too. And I went out of that to study theater, and by the end of the theater degree, I was burnt out with that and tired of writing these plays that people weren't responding to or loving, which is the theme with every work of art I've done, including architecture school and comics. Maybe OCAD was fun. That I read another band of Renegades there. Anyhow, I managed five of these Fear Itself during my undergraduate. By 1994, I went to India after I finished university, and that opened a new chapter in my life. It was back in the early 2000s that I came back to doing comics again, and I picked up with this Boopsie the Penguin character, and I decided, because now Toronto had these like comics jams and some stuff kind of like Montreal, and I was really, I didn't know what to do with myself, but I knew comics was an important part of who I was. So here you see this sort of enigmatic beginning to a pig character in a parking garage digging up a skull. It's about me rediscovering who I was and investing in the subconscious, even though, you know, it was trying to reinvest in doing comics again. And I got as far as the book one of The Cliff, which was done as a mini comic when I was starting OCAD back in 2002 to 2004. But I didn't know, it's not like you do a few of these mini comics and you distribute them to stores, but usually that's about it. You don't know who's buying and reading it. And I went into design school and then architecture school after that, and I got burned out again. And I really, between 2005 to 2010, I'd say, I didn't draw any comics. And by the end of architecture school, I quit. I didn't graduate. So I was so bitter, and I was teaching by this point, so I took a teaching job and then a principal job in a high school.
Yeah.
But after 6 years of that, when that started heading south, I went back to architecture school and did my thesis as a graphic novel, where once again I was reinvesting in doing comics. So that is a limited edition, my thesis project, which was a graphic novel about archetypal the dream space and how the subconscious affects and influences architectural form. And it culminates in my favorite city in India, so it's tying in the whole India thing in Varanasi. Now, you can say, where did I get this idea to come back to all this architecture stuff, but on my own terms? Well, it all happened pretty quickly, but it's due in large part to this book, which Mark Tessier put together. Back in the early 90s, Mark told me we had to make a mini comic that was photocopied. Then, in about, what year was this?
So this is all your Fear Itself comics?
Most of them.
Or like
it's a Mark's collection of my stuff.
Okay.
This is 2011, so Mark said, Matt, we're gonna publish a 200-page anthology of your
That's
comics.
Amazing.
There's that page that Charles liked with the bicycle. And there's other stuff in here. And I said, I laughed, because I said no one hardly reads, ever did read, or does read my stuff, but Mark wanted to do it, and this dragged me back into doing comics again.
All of you out there are going to start reading, right? We'll have links to...
I don't
to,
even know if this is still in print. I should try to get Mark to print more.
We'll have links to Matt's stuff online, and where you can buy his comics.
Mark Tessier and Stanley Wani are Edition Trip comics, Trip editions. Now, so from that, remember how we started The Cliff as a little zine format?
Yeah,
back in 2005.
Yeah.
Now, this is 2012, I think. So, I know this is 2017. So, basically 10, 12 years later,
wow.
I realized how to continue this first chapter, and I did the rest of it as I was going back.
This version is just, it was just... Book one was it until
12 years later. So that's a long gestation period.
2017, yeah.
And Mark published this, and then I was free to do what I wanted, because Mark had put together what he felt was a value from the old 1990s punk DIY subconscious surreal stuff. I had managed to put together a narrative book that told a long epic story about these characters, Poopsie, and also had Varanasi. I had done my thesis, so...
Before you go on, this is the book that got me into graphic novels and inspired me to start my own, down the journey of creating, and partly because I like to tell people, like, people who don't like comics, and we've talked about that, how I do have a bias for fine art over consider the lower art form. My mind has changed, and I have a much greater appreciation.
Matt's converted you.
Well, in God many ways, this was before seeing this, so many comic books, and I'm going to tell the story again, how when I met you 2 years ago, Mark and I had gone to...
The Toronto Comic Arts Festival.
We went through the whole space, and I didn't see anything that interested me. Literally, we went through all the floors, and the very last table we went to was Mark Tessier's table, and you were there, and we started talking, and I did end up buying Stanley Waney's book, and then went away, and I thought, oh shit, man, I met this amazing guy. We had a great talk. I talked with Mark Tessier, and you had books too, so I don't know how I contacted you.
Yeah, email.
And then we met, and I bought this, and it was like...
That was nice.
There's so much potential in the graphic novel form, because this is an amazing story. I love the loose drawing style. Yeah. I don't care what you say about drawing skills. I like this better than some of that slick stuff that I see out there with the airbrush. And yes, it's a different taste, but this is what got me into graphic novels.
Well, thank you.
And that's a lead up to your next.
Well, basically, by this point, I had finished, sort of tied up all the stuff from back when I was in high school. So what followed that was two documentary books. One is Meditation, which is, as you guys know, about what led me into meditation, starting with those visits to India back in the early 90s and culminating in, a stay in the temple and meeting some teachers, and I tried to fit that into a comic form. And then after that I did Rothko, which is about the fine artist who I like, and taking him on in a comic book, a comic strip style.
So awesome.
And the next in the triptych of documentary comics is Ornette, which is about my musical tastes. And then the big tie-up of everything will be the Poopsie graphic novel, which is where I'm at now, and the best I have to offer after 47, soon to be 48 years of life on this planet. And I don't know, even if one person reads it and reacts somewhat it will have been worth it.
Now, Poopsie started out where? In Fear Itself?
Yeah, back when I was 17 years old, I sat down my family visited Costa Rica. I remember being inspired by these different, the way buildings look down there and the way life moved at a different pace. And I drew this first page with this principal character standing at a gated enclave. And he's welcoming a new teacher. And when she goes to the classroom, she walks through a sort of tropical environment into a one-story classroom to find the students worshiping a penguin standing on a desk. And she victimizes this young penguin with an unteacherly interest, whose nature does not become apparent until she takes him to her home under false pretenses. I won't give away more than that, but that was the Poopsie character, who's this penguin with one big eye and one small eye, who is always in absurd circumstances. Now, this is the only character I've designed over the years. So people who I went to high school with, people I went to undergrad with, over the years, people remember and like this Poopsie character. He speaks to something. Back in the day, he was a bit more of a, what's the word? There was no inner life about Poopsie, really. He was just a victim of extreme circumstances, and then he has one big eye, one small eye, and he's cute. In other words, he was me as a young man in some way, probably. So the book I'm doing now, because this whole Cliff series that you read, Poopsie's a character in it, but he's a wisecracking adult detective who has spiritual guide trimmings. And the book I'm doing now looks at Poopsie's young adult life, where he goes from this inept, scared, but lovable character with no real inner life, before it becomes confident and a sort of mentor. It shows his coming of age and how he deals with being alone in this urban world and developing himself emotionally, and you know, so it's a risk, because I'm at the age I'm at now, it's not just conceptual and avant-garde. I hope to introduce emotional depth to this character and show him in a wide range of situations where he learns and screws up and develops and finds his...
Is he still a private detective?
Or he becomes that, at the end. Okay. This shows how he becomes that. So he's maturing,
basically.
Well, yeah.
Unlike Charlie Brown or some of the characters, but you know, there are characters that have been around for like 40, 50 years that don't change.
Well, that's the...
He's evolving.
Your character's evolving and changing and maturing.
That's the idea.
He's living.
Because I'm living. That's
exactly right.
Poopsie, you mentioned to me, he has one eye squinting, the other eye large,
and they
but
alternate.
They change.
Oh,
what's the significance of the alternating?
I thought it was funny.
Okay.
That's it. I thought it was funny.
And one could say that, you know, there's an inward looking eye and outward looking eye.
Oh my God, that is psychic. Yeah. Actually, the book I'm working on, Penguin Detective, explains how he ended up having one eye big and one eye small.
Okay.
Through a series of inner transformations, shamanic crisis that he undergoes. Yeah, and you're right, and becomes visionary, but compromised in terms of his normalcy in the process.
Which all shaman are. All shaman go through some kind of life crisis, as you say, shamanic illness, they actually call
they
it.
They cross
right?
the threshold.
Where there's a fragmentation of their being. And
that's what he goes through.
Let's go back to... Because I know we've talked about this once before with
the meditation.
And do you want to leave this? Because you had noticed this when we met with Matt before about
Fred's
fragmentation and how the drawing captured that whole element, which is a very shamanic.
There it is.
Very archetypal, spiritual opening.
You can see from that page there, as I cover up everybody in the background.
Finally.
What fascinated me about it, or what caught my eye about it, was how you had mentioned, as we were talking about this book previously, the traditional 9-panel format.
Yeah.
But on this page, you use that. You still maintain that format, but now it has almost a crucifix kind of look to it.
That's right.
You lay out the character, the figure, across all nine panes, almost like a Jesus-like figure, I suppose. Incredible dynamism in the layout. Can you walk us through how you came up with that concept?
Well, Fred, you know, had a series of, I guess, awakening experiences as a young man. And in one of them, after a motorcycle accident, he told me he was laying out on the operating table and he died. The surgeon told him that he was dead for a few minutes. So I wanted to show him completely vulnerable, but during that experience of broken body, which shows here literally broken between the panels.
Completely fragmented,
He became light, and he perceived everything as manifestations of light, self-effulgent light. For him, this accident, in which he died, and it was obviously terrible, physically painful, but he saw the underlying nature phenomena and became it. And I said to him during that interview, so I guess after a few months you started to see things as in their normal way we usually see them again. He said, yeah. And then he said, but it never went away. Which meant, as he was sitting there talking to me decades later, he still perceives everything as light. And his eyes are damaged now because he was doing film effects in the 70s and damaged his eyes. So although he's compromised visually in the sense that most of us navigate, he has this other vision, and I wanted to show it in comics. Yeah. And so
Fred is one of the people you studied meditation with.
Yeah, right.
And inspired you. And
I have a
bit of a link to Fred through the psychotherapy teacher and Life Space where I studied.
Yeah.
Fred studied there too prior to me, and I met him a couple times. He's a energy healer,
registered massage therapist, psychotherapeutic counselor.
So he works with energy, and he obviously has a very profound.
So this is clearly a very transformational moment that he's going through, and the way you capture that. Nine frames. In nine simple frames.
Nine simple frames.
For $9.99. But a single image.
This is how you do it.
Thank you. Profound.
Yeah. And that, again, links back to, we were talking about the shamanic experience of that fragmentation of being. And it sounds like Poopsie's going to go through that.
There's a perception of the essence of things. That's important to me as a person. And I think by this point in my life, I can tell you, that's my strength and my limitation. I perceive things. I value what's like the underlying meanings. I look for patterns. I sense them to some extent. Most people I track with seem to be much more up at the what they're seeing through their eyes. And that's good. I need people like that. But at least in art, that's a métier where you can use symbolism and boil things down to essentials and speak. If you're visually literate, like you expressed, you can. I'm trying to communicate what you got from that. That's a rewarding process, and that's, for what it's worth, what I think is important in life. Not, we have to be happy and be entertained, but there's also a sense of aligning ourselves with universal forces and finding out who we are in an energetic sense and in a deeper, meaningful sense. So that's where I'm coming to comics from. I hope I still retain a sense of humor about it, because this is, again, it's the 9-panel grid that Harvey Kurtzman used, and all the early 50s comics artists, and you know, they had to use it when they were doing commercial stuff about superheroes and funny animals and whatever. All of it goes together, and it's a limitation though, because it's so serious. I think a lot of people probably say, oh my god, I don't want to think about all this stuff, and I what is this, where's the gag at the sexy girl, and then the punch up between the villain and the hero, and the gritting the teeth in like Wolverine style slicing up, and you know, and I like that stuff when I was younger. So there you are, you know, that's where I'm at, that's what I have to offer. Like I said, I think that's
the next one can involve
I was watching
I try to throw in a sexy character. I don't know if anyone else
sexy
thinks
penguins
sexy. See, there you go.
So I was watching an interview with Robert Crumb yesterday or the day before, which I sent to you.
Yeah.
And it was an amazing interview, because he talked about how he just wanted to get personal with the comics, right? He realized he was a freak, and you know, everybody was telling him, you know, don't be a freak. And he's like, well, you know, basically, fuck you, I'm going to be a freak. I'm going to put that out there, this confessional. I think the clip
personal.
Was actually called the Urge to Confess, or I don't know, they called it something.
Oh, yeah,
like that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That he has this compulsion, it's called the compulsion to reveal truth and talk about things that people don't want to talk about. And I mean, you're not getting into that, like he gets into all kinds of weird fetishes, you know, sexual fetishes, and you know, he starts pushing buttons around racism and stuff like that. But this is almost like the next level, is talking about spiritual evolution. And what I like to think about is multi-dimensional being, living on all those levels, so spiritual, the emotional, the mental, the physical, the subatomic, whatever, all
and
those
still
things.
Functioning in the level with the kitchen and food that has to be cooked, and a baby whose diaper needs changing, and a significant other who wants to go shopping for clothes, and they're all real and important, and taking out the garbage. But if I can't do this other comics part, I have to do it. That's the thing. I have to do these projects for my sanity, for whatever reason.
Do you feel as a person who makes comics, but also has a family, a young family, do you feel yourself living in sort of blocking off your life in 9 panels? This panel is for the daughter, this panel is for cooking, this panel is for maybe these panels here. Feel fragmented,
compartmentalized. It's all in the same book, but it's being compartmentalized for sure. And that's the organizational strategy. That's a good point.
Now you're clearly using organizational strategies, otherwise you wouldn't be producing such amazing work. But you feel the tension sometimes.
Well, like I told you, I have a normal job, relatively normal. I'm a teacher.
That's another compartment, yeah.
Well, it's become what I do professionally. I love teaching. It's an important profession. I've mostly done it through intuition in my life, and as an artist, how I make art, it has informed how I teach, because I sense what seems like a thing that will be dynamic and interesting for the students, and there's a framework of things that have to be communicated and understood. But I know a lot of people around me, I'm seeing, they have their own ways of doing things. I don't remember why I started.
So what you're seeing is not so much tension.
Yes, there's a tension between these
things. We're talking about compartmentalized.
I think comics is a way for me to synthesize all of the other stuff. Otherwise, it's a soup, and it might be disassociated. And I do meditation every day. That's even more important. So when you identify with pure awareness and that field which generates phenomena, the field of limitless potential that Fred and other teachers talk about, trust Fred, that's where everything manifests from. So I know it's a creative thing, and comics is creative, and creativity is positive, even if it's about anguish or destruction. And that's better in this, especially in this world. We have to do that, right? And as a father, I want to be a father who's a model for creativity and positivity, because it's hard in this world. Yeah. It's not always easy to be positive about the way the world is going, or consumer society and all these electronic stuff. I mean, there's good stuff about it, and there's soul-destroying stuff about it. So maybe it's a healing aspect for myself, and I hope transformative. I hope to have these conversations with people. And I want people, if they see books like this, to feel validated for themselves. And say, hey, I can do comics in my terms, in my way, that still refers to what other people do. Why not? It should be that. Everyone can see that. And we should do that.
Go out there and buy Matthew's comics. The link is here. You hold the link. We're gonna have your website and very connections links right here at this place
that.
In the
get
film.
In touch with me. I'd happy
and
to talk to you.
We'll include is it Ambient Zero or Zero Ambient Comics?
Ambient Zero at Blogspot is my website.
So we'll include that in the video, and people can check out Matt's stuff
online.
And I'm sure there'll be a contact there.
Yep.
Come to his house. Unless he invites you.
you can find my books at the Beguiling in Toronto, at Page and Panel, and a number of Silver Snail.
Is it Comixology
shops.
Online?
Some of the books are as ebooks, yes, on Comixology.
Yeah.
Mark Tess, you can get to him through Edition Trip or Trip Editions, these ways.
We'll include that in here too. And I'm also going to include a link to a previous film done by Val Peter. Which is amazing.
An interview from a few years ago.
Yeah, so it'll give you some more background if this is intriguing you. And
thank you.
Thank you so much, Matt.
Thanks,
so
guys.
Amazing to see your process and
great.
And your books. And wait for Ornette and Lucy.
Yeah.
Can't wait. Very inspiring.